A single in this case, at least a single HTTP request is not enough because we need, when we response related to the user, we miss some information, we miss data, we need to send HTTP requests to fetch them. And there is another related problem, it's the plus one problem. It means that every time I have a relation, I need to wait parent of this relation, then create an extra request. If I have a collection of, for instance, and I want to retry every single post of this collection, I need to make the request for the collection, then a request for every post in this collection. So it's a very well-known issue with REST API to introduce a latency. Another problem is the overwriting problem. This time, it's in a HTTP request, you retry a lot of data, big JSON, for instance, don't display the screen all the data that you generated. You waste bandwidth and you waste computation, you resources, thing because it's. There is a well-known alternative to REST that fixes this problem. It's called GraphQL. Basically, but I think most of you is already aware of GraphQL, the client can, in the server of what it needs, exactly what it needs, and only what it needs. So in a single HTTP request, the client will ask everything it needs, and the server will reply with everything that has been related, with that has been related, including connections between. But do we still need GraphQL with HTTP? HTTP is the new protocol with the version of HTTP deep from the ground up to make the web. It's a binary protocol, so by design it's faster. It supports multiplexing, it supports request prioritization, it means that client and server can negotiate what is the important resources and they will be downloaded first. It has support server. We'll speak a bit more about that in a few minutes. It has support for either question, and there is a new version again of the protocol of HTTP that is being deployed called HTTP3. It's again a new version that introduces a lot of performance improvements, and the main thing is that instead of using HTTP, it uses UDP. One very interesting capability of HTTP2 is multiplexing. It means that in a single TCP or UDP with HTTP3 connection, you can download in parallel as many HTTP responses as you need. It's the same thing for the request. You can send in parallel as many requests needed. So this is one of the most important bottleneck of HTTP, and its built. The second very interesting capability is push. HTTP 1, let's say that you have a web page, index.html. This page, to display those, needs two extra files, the application.js file and style.css. And the CSS file has responses to images. Basically, what we your web browser loading the index.html page, when it will be loaded, it will start passing the HTML, it will the references, and at this point, it will extra HTTP request. This creates waterfall, but this is not something that is very optimal because as web developers, we know that it's not necessary. We know that we display users, the client, we have to download all the files at the same time. So, something that is possible with HTTP2, it's called HTTP2 server push. Basically, the web developer can say, okay, the client will read the index.html page, and the server will push exactly at the same time and in parallel, thanks to multiplexing, all files that are to be the script will bypass the HTML that is the JavaScript, for instance, then it will already be in a cache called the push cache and will be able to be used instantly. HTTP is already supported by all browsers and almost every internet have software that supports out of the box. So you right now, and if it's not your servers are not configured to use HTTP right now, you should do it because even without server push, it has very impressive. So let's speak about Vulkan. And it's two things. First, it's a protocol that has been internet driven that is public on GitHub and on the IETF website. So it's the specification Tiny protocol. There is also in the same Git repository a reference implementation that is a gated server, a repository that is to use, that is open source, that is written so that you put the existing web API to enable Vulkan this API without having to buy the existing code. These examples I use the API Mastodon, the Activity Pub API. So it's a centralized source solution. I did not speak about the concept of behind this API, but have something outbox. It's a JSON document. You can retrieve the REST API needed by Mastodon. These outbox are relations to activities. And activity relation to the object here, status. So it means that the status is in the outbox. You have to make a lot of requests and you have waterfall. Because first, you need to download the outbox resource. Then you need to parse it using a JSON parser to find the relation to the status to the activity in the order key. To start new HTTP requests, the activities. Then every activity has to a and activity upload, then you need a HTTP request to unload the status. So you have a lot of can enter a new HTTP reader called that takes as value a set when JSON document will be a JSON pointer, and you can in the set that you can with relations and traverse all relation graph. Here with this vector that I need all activities in the order, and for all activities I need the status will be in the object of the activity. HTTP 2 server push, a Vulkan API, when the first outbox request will be sent, in rest this it will run with the data that are needed, the HTTP responses that are needed, the output, all the activity, all the status. How to use this in JavaScript? Actually, you have nothing to do. It's transparent client side. Here I use Firefox in Chrome, Firefox in Safari, everywhere. So I use the fetch native function, request to the box on, and as my Vulkan HTTP headers, preload HTTP header. And I say I want all relations under the items. Then I decode the JSON document, I loop over the order items, and I do another batch HTTP request to find the related activities. But actually, because of HTTP 2 server push, the reply, the responses will have been loaded in parallel with the outbox. So fetch will return instantly because the data will be already there. So it's very, very easy to use. If you use the Chrome network, for instance, you can see it looks. So basically, if you don't use Vulkan, it's what the left, Then you have waterfalls. You need to wait for the outbox to start downloading the activity. And you need to wait for the activity to start downloading the statuses. When you use Vulkan, everything is loaded in parallel as replies of the first request, and there are no more waterfalls. It's downloaded instantly. So you have a very impressive performance boost. So it fixes the underfetching problem. It fixes plus one problem. It allows to download all resources in parallel thanks to the multiplexing capabilities of HTTP. Allows to use the HTTP cache mechanism. So for instance, if one activity, the one of ID 1, is has already been seen by this browser and already in cache, then the browser will not download this one. Download only the activities and in right. It's a two-fast API. And it can leverage all the capabilities of the protocol. So there is another option that is less interesting in my opinion, but still in Vulkan, that allows to filter the request to the overfetch. So you use the field HTTP header to, with the same kind of select to check the properties you want. In this example, the property appearing in the fields will be done. All the other properties of these JSON documents will be stored by the server, not be downloaded. So there are other capabilities in Vulkan, the ability to use other kind of select, for instance, XML, compatible mode with HTTP1, ability to use parameters instead of HTTP headers, and support for hypermeet. This is a implementation that you can use for to turn existing API into a Vulkan API. This server is Go, open source, and you download it right now. There are Docker images and everything you need to use it right now to test Vulkan on top of your API without having to implement anything yourself. To do this, you download this Go by set the link of your upstream API, and you have a working API. Vulkan is also able to use any non-API activity. API is an IDA one with URL as identifiers everywhere. But you can have a legacy API, a traditional API, where the functions will use plain ID. Yeah, if I have a book related to an author, but I don't know the URL of this author, Vulkan cannot get what is the URL to push. You can use OpenAPI certification, the earlier known as Swagger, to document the relations in the document. And the Vulkan Gateway server will be able to use your OpenAPI specification and will be able to find, to construct the relations, the URLs of relations thanks to the documentation. And so it will work when you will use a proper Vulkan selector. For instance, you will ask when you download the book to also push the related. If you have a Swagger, it will work as expected, even if your API is not an item. So let's speak just quickly, just a bit about GraphQL. Vulkan HTTP2 server push has a big benefit over GraphQL is a big JSON document. With GraphQL, you will ask the to construct a JSON document containing all the relations, all the resources that you need, and you will download that. It's not the case with Vulkan, where it's proper HTTP requests that are done. And so it means that the multiplexing will be used. It will be your server will be able to generate responses in parallel, and thanks to the multiplexing, your client will be able to download all the resources in parallel. It's not possible to download a big JSON document in parallel. Also, there is the ability to use full power of the cache, the HTTP cache, and it's not with GraphQL because of the same. Well, it's more than just a way to fix the header and the overfetching problem. It's also a query language, a type and then it has a built-in introspection mechanism, subscriptions, grid tooling, and Vulkan has nothing like that. But Vulkan is just tiny, a layer of HTTP layers that you use with your or REST API. And REST has everything to this gap too. It has open API, obviously, formerly known as Swagger. It has an internet scale type system that is standardized by the W3C that is called JSON-LD and using our. It has an hypermedia introspection system, very, very cool, that is called that is under the umbrella of the W3C too. If you attended to my talk last year, or in 2018 actually, about Mercure, you can see that in REST, it's very easy to use this protocol to do something like what you have subscription. It's another thing that you can use for your APIs. Obviously, GraphQL has a very good thing, but REST has nice tooling too. And GraphQL has a big problem over REST APIs is that everything that is leveraging the capability of HTTP protocol, like server, so as Varnish, web application firewall to detect sensitive requests, localizers to check what are the most requested resources, go access, API gateway tools, they just see a request to post GraphQL. With REST API, with Vue, all the benefits of being able to use the full capability of the HTTP protocol. And regarding the tooling, you can very easily create very impressive REST API using the API platform framework, obviously, it also supports REST and GraphQL, but it's very, very easy. It has native support for Vulkan. There is similar tools, for instance, there is GraphQL that is very interesting in Ruby always, and client side, there are emerging data very interesting. For instance, are from Zeit, creators of Next, and try Zeit SWR with Vulkan, and it allows to download with Vulkan the HTTP responses in parallel and to render them client side using React in parallel. We are working on a new JavaScript library that will use a Vulkan nature very straightforward. It will be released in the next few days, so follow me on Twitter if you want more information about that. So Vulkan is fast, designed for the open web at its core, easy to deploy thanks to the open source gateway server, so you can have any existing API in a Vulkan one. It is compatible with all the tools in HTTP. It can be supported in minutes by your existing web API, and there is more if you really like GraphQL syntax, because it's a very nice syntax, you can use the Apollo REST Link library to execute GraphQL GraphQL queries that will hit a Vulkan server. So you have the best of both worlds. Give it a try. It's brand new, but it's promising. Thank you.